So today I'd like to talk to you about Parkinson's disease and the problem that it's going to face our society and our community in the coming years. The term the silver tsunami was not coined by me. It's one that's been in the medical literature for the last couple of years as physicians and caregivers are becoming more and more concerned about how we are going to deal with our rapidly aging population and the various diseases that they're going to be developing that will need treatment and care. There we go. So Parkinson's disease is the second most common neurodegenerative disease so far in the world. It's only behind Alzheimer's disease. It's estimated that there are over 1.5 million people who suffer from the disease today. It's thought with the aging of the baby boomers that this will double or triple in the next 20 years. Right now, it's costing us over $14 billion a year in caregiving and medical care for these patients. So, of course, this is also going to double or triple. This is a chronic neurodegenerative disease. There is no treatment. There's no cure. There's no way to stop the disease. What we do have are some palliative therapies. We treat the symptoms. We can give some drugs that replace dopamine, which is the neurotransmitter that's being lost. You hear about neurotransmitters from Rick and earlier from the other speakers. Or you can drop an electrode into particular parts of the brain and try and reestablish a circuit, and that will help with some of the motor deficits. But none of these treatments stop the disease. So at some point, these treatments fail because the disease continues to progress. Now, there's some features about this disease that people don't quite know about, and some of them are scientists don't know about this, so they're not modeling the disease as well as they could. The idea is that mostly it's men who get the disease, and that's not true. We just have some people here who have suffered or died from Parkinson's. It roughly is more men than women, but both genders can get the disease. It's not specific for any kind of nationality or ethnic background. It is your risk factor for developing the disease is aging, and so it's more common to see the disease in people over the age of 60. However, this individual was just recently diagnosed. That is a 2-year-old boy. This individual was diagnosed at 11. He is now he's now 20. He suffered from unknown neurologic complications for 6 to 7 years before physicians finally realized that what he had was actually Parkinson's disease. So this is a disorder that can reach across all ages and all people. People tend to think of Parkinson's disease as this movement disorder, this shaking. This is really when, at the end stage of the disease, that you see these motor deficits. It really starts very early on, and we think it starts now in the gut. So some of the first complications are is the loss of the myenteric plexus, which is the brain for your stomach and your GI system. This becomes dysfunctional. Patients have a lot of synuclein load in their gut, and they get constipation. As the disease progresses, it involves the autonomic nervous system. Patients will then have problems with heart rate variability and other peripheral nervous system problems. As it moves into the brain, both the motor and non-motor parts of the brain are affected. There is a very stereotypic sleep disorder. There's also anxiety and depression, which are very common in Parkinson's patients and very debilitating. They will eventually get some hyperosmosia as the olfactory bulb degenerates. This impairs their ability to eat and enjoy food. And then as the cortex becomes involved, they become demented. 30% of patients when they die are fully demented. They require 24-hour care for daily tasks of living. It is estimated that 80% of Parkinson's patients have anywhere from mild cognitive impairment to mild dementia. So the dementia is also a very common part of feature of the disease. So in trying to study the disease, you want to be able to study all aspects. So the way this disease happens, or the hallmark pathologic features of the disease, is this protein synuclein. Normally it's kind of a floppy protein, not very structurally complex, becomes, for whatever reason, misfolded, and it forms these fibrils. We don't know why this misfolding occurs, but it is the feature of PD, as well as the other synucleinopathies, which are dementia with Lewy bodies and multiple system atrophy. These fibrils then collect, and they form what are called the Lewy bodies. And these are the hallmark features that the pathologists will use on postmortem examination to make the final conclusive diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. But we think that it is these pathologic fibrils that are causing the disease. And what we think is occurring is that these fibrils, they take the normal synuclein in a cell, you just need a few misfolded alpha synuclein fibrils, and they cause the normal synuclein to misfold. So you get this amplification effect. Then these fibrils get down into the nerve terminals where they're secreted, and they're picked up by the neighboring neuron that's next door. So recently we discovered and published in Science that the protein that picks these fibrils up is LAG3. It's normally involved in the immune system. It only recognizes these fibrils. It does not recognize normal synuclein. And if you knock out LAG3, you can completely block the transmission of synuclein. You can block the progression of Parkinson's disease. So we're fairly confident that this is how the disease is progressing. We think it starts in the lower systems, in the myenteric plexus, and then moves from neuron to neuron. So where the synapses occur, that's where the fibrils move. So we have spent decades studying Parkinson's disease and defining better and better model systems. And this is our approach. We start with the patient. Some patients have genetic mutations. These are very rare. It's only 10 to 15% of the total population. We get postmortem tissue. We get biologic samples. And we use these to test hypotheses that we're developing in our animal models. So we have a sporadic model with these preformed fibrils, toxic synuclein, engineered models. And then we also have cultures derived from stem cell technologies of the brain regions, so we can reproduce the brain regions and the cell types we want to study. We get an idea using genomics, proteomics, cell biology of what the signaling, pathologic signaling pathway is. We test that, and then we try and find new therapeutics and new targets and ways to block this. When we do find a new drug, we don't just go moving into clinic immediately. We run it through the whole battery of our models to make sure that we haven't fooled ourselves and that truly is a good target. So this is what we've found over the decades. We have this alpha-synuclein aggregation. We don't know why that starts, but once it does and it gets into a cell, it causes some kind of mitochondrial dysfunction, which then activates this molecule c-Abl. Parkin is a gene that gets inactivated in familial PD, but is also inactivated always in sporadic PD. And Parkin has two targets. One is this molecule Paris, which regulates the ability of mitochondria to restore themselves. So when Paris is overexpressed, mitochondria cannot renew themselves, and they become dysfunctional. It also promotes this protein, which is involved in protein synthesis, moves out of the cytosol into the nucleus, where it activates this molecule PARP, and that sets in motion the cell death process. In addition to what's going on in the neurons, this aggregated synuclein activates microglia, and it causes normal astrocytes, which you need in your brain. They provide very health benefits to the cells that they surround. They turn them in from A2 happy astrocytes to these A1 astrocytes that go around and kill neurons. And so if you want to protect the brain, we reasoned that you had to block cell death in the neurons, but you also had to block the conversion of these astrocytes so that you didn't have this bad inflammatory response. This happens also in the autosomal recessive diseases. These models have been very handy in developing this. And so what we've done, we've developed a number of drugs that are now moving through different stages into the clinic. So knowing what these targets are, we have c-Abl inhibitors. Two companies are going into clinical trial this year. Michael J. Fox is also doing a negative study. We have inhibitors of microglial activation. That study is going into clinical trial. We just finished our funding. That will be starting at the end of the year. We are working on PARP inhibitors and PARAS inhibitors, as well as MIF inhibitors, and those are in various stages of development, but these we anticipate, at least for the PARAS inhibitors, that in a year and a half to 2 years, we will also be going into clinical studies. So in the next year, you'll be seeing, hopefully, you'll be hearing from us about our clinical trials, as well as some of the basic science of what we're trying to do to understand better how synuclein misfolds and causes this prion-like effect and how that might be also used as a biomarker. And additionally, we have some good work with neuroimaging so that we can follow the disease as it progresses or hopefully as we prevent it from progressing. So thank you very much.
I'm Carol Pearson, I'm with the Voice of America, and I interviewed a doctor who specialized in treating Parkinson's. He said that he felt that there was something related to diet. His brother had Parkinson's, and he said that after that, he was very particular about the type of food he ate and would only buy organic fruits and vegetables because he was concerned that there might be something in non-organic fruits and vegetables that could promote Parkinson's. Do you have any information on that?
So certainly there are pesticides that are thought to promote Parkinson's disease and have been used in the past to do an intoxication model in lower organisms, mice, worms, and fish. The role of the microbiome is a new and emerging area. We know that the microbiome regulates innate immunity, and innate immunity also regulates the progression of Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, stroke, the severity of the diseases. How that all is interconnected is still a work in progress. These are new areas that have just been recognized to be important, but I think you'll see a lot coming out in the next few years about how they factor in. So diet would, of course, regulate microbiome, which then may regulate, could regulate the progression of the disease. He also may just be trying to avoid some of Monsanto's drugs, which we do know can help accelerate things if they don't actually trigger.
And if I could ask one other question, what about some other diseases that have similar symptoms? I'm thinking about progressive supranuclear palsy, for example. Do we know, I mean, it's not Parkinson's, but do we know anything more about these diseases, and do they proceed in any kind of similar fashion?
So many of these neurodegenerative diseases have at their core misfolded proteins, which then seem to seed in a stereotypic pattern specific for that type of disease. I don't know specifically about supranuclear palsy. We are doing similar studies in our Alzheimer's model. And we are working with the folks at Hopkins to look at multiple sclerosis. I think that this will be a common theme, and then it'll just be which kind of prionoids these are. The synuclein that misfolds in Parkinson's disease will give mice Parkinson's disease, but not MSA. But if we take the new synuclein misfolded in an MSA patient, it will give the mice MSA. So theoretically, same protein, but there's some biophysical difference between them that causes a different disease. And that's really where we are right now, is trying to understand those aspects so that we have a better idea of how to model and then treat the diseases.
Thank you.
You had mentioned the Roundup, the glyphosate, and the chemic pathway has been demonstrated to be adversely affected by glyphosate. And I was curious because, like, ALS, Parkinson's, you know, Alzheimer's, I can go on and on. They're all characterized by this abnormal, aggregation or folding. And are we looking upstream to any of those to try to find something that can prevent us from this silver tsunami or whatever?
Right. That's a very good question. So Jay Parrish at Johns Hopkins, working with our group, he's a GI doctor. We've got some models set up using our stem cell technology to try and find out what actually would cause synuclein to fold. Would it be Would it be just an infectious agent? Could some of these toxins that we have in our environment naturally at very high levels, more than we ever thought we would, could that be a promoting cause? We are just at the early stages of this and applying for grant funding for it. I hope we have answers quickly, but taking on Monsanto is a daunting thing, so we don't want to try that.
Hi, Jenny Cook, freelance. I'm wondering about the stage at which the disease is generally diagnosed, and if it's possible at this stage to do diagnoses based on gut activity or inactivity.
Right. So typically, it's diagnosed when the patient comes in because they have a tremor. Up to this point, they've had symptoms that could belong to a host of other diseases. There are several things that are advancing this, that it could be a pre-diagnosis. One is that when you get your happy 50th birthday colonoscopy, that they might take a little deeper incision and look for synuclein aggregation because it's become clear that's early. The sleep disorder that I mentioned, a number of these patients have gone into the sleep labs to be studied and tried to be helped for this, and they've been following out over time. And of the patients that were enrolled, within 3 years, 50% have converted to Parkinson's disease. They're following the rest and anticipating within two, all of them will have PD. And so this sleep disorder may be a very good early diagnostic predictor of who's going to get Parkinson's disease. And that was published in The Lancet last year. Not by us, unfortunately.
Valina, thank you very much.
Okay, I'll come get you.